Welcome to Season 5 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former health commissioner here in Baltimore, Maryland. Our goal with this podcast is to bring scientific evidence and experience to shed light on critical health issues. If you have questions or ideas for us, please send an email to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes.
Hi, I'm Lindsay Smith-Rogers, producer of Public Health On Call. Today, Stephanie Desmon talks to Dr. Brian Garibaldi, a pulmonologist at Johns Hopkins, about how treatment for COVID patients in the ICU has evolved from 2 years ago. They discuss how the pandemic has offered the unique opportunity to study a disease in real time, what doctors have learned about treating COVID, and how those lessons will help going forward. Let's listen. Brian Garibaldi, thanks so much for joining me.
It's a pleasure to be back.
So you and I last spoke in April 2020, at the beginning of the pandemic, and I asked you about what COVID looked like in the hospital, and you spoke of the urgency of trying to figure out how to treat people with this new disease. And I'm curious what sort of roller coaster we have seen and what we have learned.
Wow, I can't believe it's been over 2 years since we last spoke. It is amazing to think about what we've learned over the last 2 years with this new disease. And, you know, I say that both from a pharmacologic perspective, you know, the medicines that we now have to both treat, but also to prevent disease, but also the way that we're able to approach caring for these patients in real time. And even, you know, at the level of research, what we've been able to accomplish in terms of learning from the patient data that we've collected to try to understand the effectiveness of different approaches and to really inform care moving forward, it really has moved the field of precision medicine, which is this idea that you want to select the right treatment for the right patient at the right time, really has moved that forward, I think, years or even decades, because we were faced with such a monumental problem and with so many patients infected with the same disease, we were able to gather a tremendous amount of data in real time and then turn that around and provide real-time tools and prediction models to clinicians on the front lines, which really did change the way that we approached care for patients. So maybe we can start with just some of the phenomenal advances in therapeutics. And I think we have to start with vaccines. So when we spoke in April of 2020, the hope was that sometime in the next year or maybe 2 years, we would have a vaccine that would be able to prevent, you know, maybe 50% of infections. That's what we had sort of set the benchmark for. If we had a vaccine that was 50% effective, we'd be really, really happy with that. And just 8 months from the time that we spoke in December of 2020, we had two vaccines that were more than 90% effective at preventing symptomatic infection with the first variants of SARS-CoV-2 and virtually prevented all severe disease and hospitalization in patients who didn't have underlying conditions that make them not able to respond to vaccines. And what that really has meant over the last several months in particular, you know, with the Omicron surge over the last winter, it really meant that while there were some people who were coming into the hospital having been vaccinated and getting sick with COVID, the vast majority of patients who were coming into the hospital sick with COVID were unvaccinated, or they had some underlying immune condition which made it hard for their bodies to respond to the vaccine. And so in the last several months, particularly as cases have gone down across the US and here in Maryland, the few patients that are coming into the ICU now with COVID are those individuals who either have not gotten vaccinated or have an underlying condition that makes them not able to respond to vaccines. So it's pretty amazing that even though the effectiveness of the vaccines against symptomatic COVID has gone down with newer variants, there still is tremendous protection against severe disease, hospitalization, and death. And that's pretty amazing. And that's the reason why we're seeing now, as the BA2 variant is the majority of variants in the US, and we are seeing infections tick up a little bit, we have not seen hospitalizations rise, and we have not seen deaths rise. It really is the protection from those vaccines. And to be fair, the protection from individuals who had prior COVID infections. So part of it's natural infection, but the vast majority of these benefits are from people who have gotten the vaccines. And I think now the challenge is really to encourage people who had gotten the first two doses of an mRNA vaccine or the single dose of the Johnson & Johnson vaccine, it's really to encourage them to get at least their first booster, because we know that first booster really restores that important protection against severe disease and death. So I think that's the most astounding achievement over the last couple of years for COVID. But at the same time, you know, for individuals who do become sick, we now have treatments that we can offer that we know work. And those treatments really can be divided up into different buckets. There's the antiviral treatments that prevent the virus from replicating or reproducing within the body. And then we have anti-inflammatory treatments, which if someone does develop severe disease from COVID, we're able to shut down that inflammatory process and improve their outcomes. And so there are a number of different antiviral treatments that are available. Probably the one that has been most widely used is remdesivir, which is an IV antiviral medicine that targets the RNA polymerase, which is the way that the virus can multiply and replicate itself. And that drug has been shown for hospitalized patients to decrease the time it takes to get better. And in large retrospective studies has been associated with an improvement in mortality. Now we actually understand that if you give remdesivir as an outpatient therapy for 3 days instead of the full 5-day course, you can actually decrease the likelihood that someone's going to be hospitalized. And so remdesivir, I think, was an important addition to our ability to treat COVID patients. Monoclonal antibodies, many people have heard of, I would classify also as an antiviral therapy. They're basically giving you a laboratory engineered antibody against the spike protein of SARS-CoV-2 so that your immune system can recognize it and clear it before you develop a severe disease. And there have been a number of monoclonal antibodies that were available, and they, across the board, have decreased the likelihood that someone's going to get hospitalized if you deliver these therapies to them before they get sick. The monoclonals have changed over time because different variants don't respond well to different monoclonals. So actually right now, we only have one that's in circulation for BA2, but it's still effective at reducing hospitalization. We also have something called convalescent plasma, which is basically taking the plasma of a person who is infected with COVID, who has made antibodies against SARS-CoV-2, and then giving that to another patient who has not yet had a chance to make antibodies. And we now know that if you deliver high titer antibody plasma early on in someone's disease course, you can reduce the likelihood that they're going to get hospitalized. What I think has really been a game changer over the last several months is the fact that we now have oral antiviral therapies that can be administered as pills. The most commonly used one is Paxlovid, which is a Pfizer product. And if you give that to somebody early, within 3 to 5 days of their symptom onset, it has been shown to reduce the risk of hospitalization at about the same level as the monoclonal antibodies. And so we're now reaching a point where, as we have more availability of this drug, if someone is high risk for developing severe disease, they become symptomatic, they test positive, we can get them an oral antiviral agent fairly quickly and try to reduce the likelihood that they're going to develop severe disease or death.
At the beginning, I feel as though you had no idea what to do with people. You put them on a ventilator if they were sick, and you didn't know if they were going to come off. I imagine a lot of them did not survive. I assume that the ones that get to you also have a better chance of survival.
We have seen improvements in patients who get very, very ill and require ICU level care. I will say they're modest improvements. When someone has severe COVID and develops what we call acute respiratory distress syndrome, or ARDS, and that's basically their lungs are failing and you need to support them with mechanical ventilation, we still see, unfortunately, a mortality of about 30% in those patients. What we have been able to do with some patients is treat them with anti-inflammatory medicines to try to improve their lung disease before they get put on a ventilator, or to try to give them a better chance of coming off the ventilator if they do make it to that point. The two most commonly used medicines are dexamethasone, which is a corticosteroid, which was shown in a large study in the UK to reduce mortality in patients who had COVID and required oxygen. So that includes patients on a mechanical ventilator. But we also have some other anti-inflammatories like tocilizumab, which targets an inflammatory pathway called IL-6. In certain patients who are very, very ill, giving them tocilizumab, in addition to trying to get them an antiviral early and likely using dexamethasone, has been shown to decrease the likelihood of them going on a ventilator or the likelihood of them dying. So we definitely have tools that we can use in the ICU to try to improve someone's chances of coming off a ventilator. But I think our best weapons are still trying to prevent disease as best we can with vaccines and with non-pharmacologic therapies like masking and social distancing when necessary, trying to get to people early if they do become infected and get them these antiviral therapies, and then really using these anti-inflammatory therapies only when someone becomes very, very ill.
So moving forward, hoping there'll be a post-COVID pandemic world, what are some things that you've learned that you'll be able to use to treat other patients who have some other disease or just your regular ICU patients?
So maybe the most important lesson from both a clinical and a clinical research side is the need to be able to gather data quickly and efficiently, but also the need to be able to share that data widely. And so what we've learned with our COVID Precision Medicine Center of Excellence is that, you know, we've been able to work with our data scientists to create ways of bringing clinical data out from the electronic health record, getting that into the hands of researchers, and then being able to look for patterns and to look for signs or signals that help us predict who's going to develop severe disease or death. And, you know, that helps us to have conversations with families, that helps us to understand who might be a candidate for a clinical trial. But it also allows us to try to link the pathophysiology of what's happening. You know, why is somebody getting sick with this clinical data, and to really guide basic science researchers towards understanding mechanisms of disease so that we can develop better testing, better therapeutics. And so, you know, I think a good example of that here was, you know, our microbiology lab led by Heva Mustafa has been sequencing, you know, virtually all of the viruses that we've seen here at Johns Hopkins over the last year. And we've been able to now link the different variants of those viruses with clinical outcomes and understand, you know, which variants might be associated with worsening disease outcomes. We've also been working with basic scientists who study autoantibodies. And Anthony Rosen and Livia Casciola-Rosen and a large group of scientists have been able to link severe COVID in some patients to an autoantibody against the ACE2 receptor, which gives us an idea of how SARS-CoV-2 may actually be causing inflammation and maybe causing damage to certain organs. And that provides opportunities to develop better tests for those patients, but also to understand the likely treatments that would work, like dexamethasone, for example, which could shut down an autoantibody response. The other big lesson that I think we're learning from the research side is that we need to work together to translate data into common data models. You know, we've had 12,000 or so inpatients with COVID in the Johns Hopkins health system. We can share that data with other health systems, and 12,000 becomes 120,000 or 12 million. And your ability to learn at scale is just dramatically increased when you can speak the same data language and be able to actually look at outcomes across many different health systems and across many different geographic areas. And so there are a lot of really productive consortiums that have come out of COVID, including the National Cohort, COVID Cohort Collaborative, or the NC3, the HCA Healthcare Charge data set, which were part of both of those cohorts. It really has led to rapid discovery about risk factors for severe disease and assessing the real-world effectiveness of certain therapeutics, right? You know, the trial on remdesivir that led to its FDA approval only had about 1,500 patients. We were able to look at remdesivir in 50,000 patients and really confirm, all right, do those benefits really hold up when you start applying this medicine to people who maybe didn't quite meet the inclusion criteria of a clinical trial and who had different demographic characteristics? For example, we in our studies, we've had much higher numbers of underrepresented minorities. So we're more comfortable saying, hey, this remdesivir drug actually does work in many different types of people, not just the people who were included in the clinical trial. You know, I do think we also have learned some important lessons in terms of the need to scale up testing very, very quickly. You know, I think there certainly was a delay in our ability to understand how widespread SARS-CoV-2 infection or COVID was in the United States back in the spring of 2020 because we had delays in getting wide access to tests. You know, initially, the idea was to have the CDC be sort of the central point for developing those tests and distributing them, and that obviously did not work. And so this need to have a partnership between federal agencies, private academic institutions, public institutions, but also pharmaceutical companies and technology companies, I think has really shown the value of that engagement. And that's true for vaccines, but also for testing. I think we need to continue to build that capability to be able to understand where the next pathogen might be coming from. We know that a lot of these pathogens, that you know, these respiratory viruses, a lot of them have animal hosts. And they probably make multiple jumps from animals to humans before a variant of that virus takes hold and then becomes to spread from person to person. And so I think there's an important lesson there in terms of our ability to do wider surveillance on what's actually circulating in animal hosts that might be making the jumps to humans so that we can actually pre-prepare tests, have a battery of diagnostics that could be available and tweaked depending on what pathogen comes next, but also starting to think about therapeutics that can work across a wide variety of different respiratory viruses or other pathogens that might come up in the future. And I think it is important to remember, you know, if we just think about coronaviruses, you know, over the last 20 years, we've had three coronaviruses that have sort of popped up as new coronaviruses, right? There was SARS-CoV-1 in the early 2000s, and there was MERS-CoV in the 2010s, and then SARS-CoV-2. And each one has been worse than the one before. So it's very likely that we're going to see another respiratory virus, maybe a coronavirus, maybe a variant of influenza. And we do need to enjoy the post-COVID lull in cases and getting back to some of the activities that we enjoyed before the pandemic. But we also need to be very mindful that this could happen again. We need to be better prepared.
Brian Garibaldi, thanks so much for joining me.
Well, it's been a pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Public Health On Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmon. Audio production by Niall Owen McCusker, Matthew Martin, Spencer Greer, and Holly Cardinale, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo. Social media support from Grace Holz Fernandez. Thank you for listening.